shaded in the window. The table shared a screen to fold. Someone standing by the open door. I can see the bridge, the river. Oh, I must be near forever. Oh, I've never been this homesick before.
Watching us via Facebook. We welcome you. We say hey to all of you out there. We talk to our Facebook family tonight. We say welcome. Come join us tonight as we have a time of worship and as we have a time of sharing the Word of God with you tonight here at Life Center Pentecostal Holiness Church. Tonight, as we open up, I want to take just a few moments as we have our offering tonight, as our church family is preparing that offering in their homes right now. We're going to pray as we give on Wednesday nights. This particular Wednesday night, it goes toward our school of ministry, which is to enable us to help our ministers that are out there trying to get their credentials. We believe in supporting them, and so tonight our offering will go toward the School of Ministry. And in this place, if you want to, we want you to know you can go online to lcphk.org. That once again is lcphk.org, and you can give online. It is a secure site, and we just want you to feel free to be able to give, or either mail it to P.O. Box 738, Kingstree, South Carolina, 29556. As we go to the Lord in prayer tonight, we are lifting up all of those that are being affected by the coronavirus, not only those that have had the germ to get in them, the virus to get in them, but also for everyone that is at home and affected through their jobs and all of the situations that are going on, those that are sick, and it's not the coronavirus, but it's something else, and so they are sick as well. We have some in our church family that are having sickness in their body right now, and as we go to the Lord in prayer, we just ask for you to join with us as we pray for our sick and as we pray over the needs of our people. Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight, Lord, as we open up this service. And Lord, we know that, God, there is a lot that is happening in our world right now. Lord, we know that there are people that have been infected with this virus that has spread worldwide. And God, that there have been many who have died. But praise the name of Jesus, there are very high numbers of those who have recovered, Lord God, from this virus. And we want to give you all of the praise for that. But tonight, Lord, there's more going on than just the coronavirus. There are people that are home tonight, Lord God, that are suffering, Lord, with cancer and with sinus issues and, Lord, with other ailments in their bodies. There are other diseases that are taking place in their lives right now. And, Lord, we just extend our hand, Lord, toward them right now. And, Lord, we just believe that the healing virtue of Almighty God will flow through us and into them, and that, Lord, their faith will arise and they will recognize and know that the stripes that you took upon your back, Lord, was not just for one person healing, but Lord, it was for everyone's healing. And so tonight, Lord, we pray that, God, you will take the offering that is being given, that you will take the ones, Lord God, that are lifting up their name right now, Lord, in prayer, that Jesus, you will bring the healing that they need. And for all of this, Lord God, we will give you praise, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We ask you to join us as tonight our numbers have been cut down again. Instead of 10, it's down to 3. And so that just limits us tonight to our sound and our video and myself in the church. So tonight we have a worship song, and we want you just to take the time to worship the Lord with us in this house as we play this video.
Into waters unexplored, this one desire stirring here in me, deep is calling out to deep. Take me from where I've been into something new. I'm giving. Thank you.
Because he is our hope today. I want you to turn in your Bibles with me tonight as we turn to Matthew chapter 10 and verse 16. This is a word the Lord laid upon my heart just the other day as we were preparing for Sunday service, and he placed this in my heart saying to share this on Wednesday night. And for those of you that are watching us via Facebook, we ask you just to comment or to send an amen. Hey, we're a Pentecostal church here, so we like feedback and we love to hear it. And even though I can't hear it from this pulpit right now, nor can I see it, I can go back later and know you were tuned in and you were worshiping the Lord along with me. So I'm believing those amens, and I'm believing those praise the Lord's will come in. But Matthew 10 and 16 says this to us tonight. Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Therefore, be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. When I read this scripture, I realize that even with the disciples, when Jesus sent them out, he sent them in the midst of trouble. There were wolves are not creatures of comfort. They are not pets that we can walk up to and stroke with our hands. They are not the typical house cat or the trained dog. They are predators that are feared among creatures as well as feared among men. And this is what the Lord was saying to them. It was to this type that Jesus sent them forth, among predators. He sent them out in spite of those predators. He sent them out anyway because of those predators, and he sent them out for that very reason, because there were predators in the earth, and the Lord was sending his disciples out. He sent them out as sheep, a breed of animal that is unable to defend themselves against any predator, much less one as aggressive as a wolf, an animal that basically does not think for itself, but must be guarded and led by a shepherd. Their greatest defense is their shepherd. So it is ours as well. And Jesus said to them, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Oh my. And it speaks to us today so clearly that we are living in a time when there are people that want to pick and they want to argue and they want to be offended by every word that we say, to the point of where it makes the church not want to open its doors up to online services because we don't want to be mocked. We don't want to be jeered at. Listen, I came from Greer, South Carolina. I came from the foothills area, and some of you that may be watching tonight remember me from the days of when I lived in Greer. But many years ago, in fact, it's been 21 years now that the Lord sent us out, and I tell people here among us that the Lord told me that I was to trade the mountains for the swamp, and that's exactly what we did as we came to the lower part of the state. And so here I am with this deep southern voice that I cannot deny. No matter where I go, people know I am southern to the bone, and it's this mix of low country vocabulary mixed along with the hillbilly mountain talk that I grew up in. And so it makes me a little defensive and a little afraid to get online and start sharing, because I don't want people making fun of me. But you know what? The Lord is saying, I'm bringing you out from all of that. And he is saying to us as the body of Christ today, the very same thing. He is saying, don't be afraid of how you talk. Don't be afraid of how you look. Just go out and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, because he is our shepherd and he is here to cover us. He is our greatest defense. He is truly our only defense. But he told us to be wise as serpents. See, God's not looking for fools. He doesn't want someone standing behind his pulpit acting a fool and saying foolish things. He's looking for people to walk in his wisdom when they go out. A snake is severely handicapped. They have no legs. They have no arms. They have an ability to get away from a predator, not so very quickly, except for just a few breeds. Yet it can hide, it can maneuver, and it can protect itself from its predators. We too may appear as though we are handicapped, but we too, as the snake, must be aware of our surroundings, and we must be aware of the predators that seek us. To one you stand and you face that opponent face to face. To the other, you retreat stealthily and hide back until it is to your advantage and guided by the Holy Spirit to confront. You say, oh yeah, snakes, Pastor, have venom. But I want you to know today, Jesus said about his word that it was a two-edged sword that cuts asunder between bone and marrow too. His word, he said, it states that it will remove mountains and it will calm seas and it will divide lands and it will conquer death and it will heat coals of fire upon those who rise up against you today. So I ask you tonight, which is the greater defense? And I stand here today being able to tell you that it's God's word and it is God's defense that will fight your battles for you. He says, stand up and be counted for this day. But he said, be wise as serpents, but be harmless as doves. See, doves having no defense other than their ability to fly. I know no one that is afraid of a dove. To this we recognize why God chose the dove to bring the good news to Noah on the ark and to bring good news to mankind by descending on the Christ as he rose from the waters of baptism. The dove represents good news, and I'm here to tell you tonight, I bring you good news. The Lord has equipped us. The Lord has made us ready, and the Lord will use us in this day and time because he will take us no matter what or how we may speak. He will take us and use us. You know, Moses' biggest argument with Jesus or with God was this one thing. He says, I stutter, God, but I want you to know his stuttering didn't keep God from using him. And God will use us all no matter what we feel our handicaps are. We have been sent by the Lord to a world that is as ravaging and as predatory as wolves in the wilderness. But we have the great shepherd to show us the way. We must not be fearful and afraid in these days. That was what I heard the Lord say to me. I have stood and I have taught class with hundreds and even thousands. I have taught and I have preached among many for many years. But the thought of going live, it just somehow scared me because I thought of it this way, that I didn't want to lose the presence and the purity of the Holy Spirit's moving in our services. I didn't want to be scrutinized by onlookers, spectators, and mockers. I didn't want to cast our pearls among swine for them to laugh and jeer at because of a lack of understanding how the work of the Holy Spirit is. Then I realized that this is what Jesus was saying. He says, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves, but don't put on a show. Just lift me up. And so I think that today, whenever we stand behind the pulpit, if it's on Facebook Live or on YouTube, I think it's causing all of us as ministers of the gospel to lay aside our opinions about things and start preaching sincerely from the Word of God, that we give them the Word of God and leave our opinions in our chairs back home, because the world doesn't need my opinion and it doesn't need your opinion. What the world needs is the Word of God coming alive inside of them. And God has called you and I, ministers of the gospel, to go forth and preach it with all of our hearts. Believers, he is calling us to come out from among them and be separate and lift up the light of Jesus Christ among us. This will be part of the great fulfillment as we hear prophets speaking today about the impact of this virus worldwide. Jesus told us in Matthew in 28:18-20, that he came and he said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Amen. In Acts, we read of the dispersing of the saints throughout Asia. It didn't come because they were getting crowded in Jerusalem. It didn't come because there was a split in the Jerusalem church. It came because there was persecution that came and pushed them to make decisions. We must understand today, we have been pushed, church. We have been pushed outside of our four walls. We have been pushed to do church a new way and a different way. We are being pushed to be able to worship God in our homes, just like he told us in Deuteronomy, that we are to worship him when we lay down. We are to worship him when we rise up. We are to sit down and teach it to our children. We are to be busy about teaching and worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ wherever we may be. And though you may be being pushed right now in your home, well, it's not the same as when I go to church. I'm here to tell you, I hear the Holy Spirit saying, push through, push through. Worship me where you are, because from the very depths of your heart, and even if you're alone in your home, lift up holy hands unto the Lord and worship him, for he is to be worshiped at all times. At all times. Hallelujah. Acts 8 and 1 tells us, now Saul was consenting to his death. Speaking of Stephen's death, at that time, great persecution arose against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And there were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except for the apostles. When I read this verse, and I look at it, it says persecution arose against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. Now, we may think we've got it tough right now. I've even heard some say, Pastor, these 14 days being cooped up in the house are really driving us all up the wall. But I want to tell you, that's a small price to pay compared to the early Christians that in the process of their persecution were driven away from their homes, were driven out of their homeland, driven away from everything that was familiar to them. They had to leave because of the persecution. It tells us why, because in verse 3 it says, for as Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering every house and dragging off men and women, committing them to prison. Do I stay in Jerusalem? They ask. I can just imagine them sitting around the table at night, just like some of you have had to do. I'm here to tell you, I've cooked more meals in the last week than I've cooked in a month, because we're here at home and we're here together. And here they are huddled down in Jerusalem. They are hearing stories. Did you hear? Two streets down, they've already come in and taken Joe and taken Jane. They've taken them into prison. Have you heard? They've taken the children. Have you heard? So-and-so got killed today. They're hearing all of this news, and in their mind, around their place of coming together as a family, the thoughts are going through their head. Do I stay in Jerusalem and fight, or do I take my family and leave for safety? I'm here to tell you, they were in a terrible place. They were in a difficult time, and they had to make difficult decisions. No one wanted to leave their homes. But what good did it do to stay if all they were going to do was be killed? And the scriptures say, and they all were scattered throughout the regions. Where did they go? Where did they go? Why did they settle in the specific areas that they settled in? My thoughts ran this way. Could it be they went to grandma's town? Let's go visit grandma for a couple of weeks and see if it settles down. Oh, let's go over to my cousin's house over in Samaria. Let's go over there and let's just stay with them, and maybe it'll die down a little bit, and then we can come back to Jerusalem. Or let's go to visit our friends. You know, they've been wanting us to come for about a year or so now. Let's go visit them. And just left a place of safety, because it's no longer safe, but a place of persecution. No matter the reason, this is what we do know. They packed up and they left. They prayed. They believed God's word to keep them, and they dispersed. I can imagine, as we have felt here, even at Life Center, I miss my people here. We miss one another. We miss the hugs. We miss the ability to embrace and grab hands together and pray together. We miss being able to gather together in this church house together and sing the praises of God together. We miss all of that. Well, I want you to know they missed it too. They missed their friends. They missed their synagogue. They missed all of that. But they left because They had to. They prayed. They believed God's word, and they dispersed. But this is what I want to leave with us in this house tonight. They didn't lose faith in God or in the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and neither can we. Right before I came to do this video tonight, I heard a prophetical word of a young preacher that got on there and was really speaking to President Trump, telling him and begging him to call for a time of repentance across America. He even challenged him. He said, I know that there are principalities and powers. There are people in great places that will rise up against it and refuse it. But he said, this country, we need to repent of the sin that we have committed. And I'm here to tell us tonight that we can still have faith in God. We need to have faith in Him more than we ever have. We need to be a repentant body of believers and say to everyone that Jesus Christ is alive and well, and He is working in us, and He is working through us, and He is still the resurrection and the life. He is still the truth and the way, and there is no way to heaven except by Him. Tonight, I want us to know this is the message they shared. They shared their testimony of faith. They told others what the Lord had done for them, and we must be busy about telling others instead of what the coronavirus is trying to do and how much fear we have. We must learn that we must share what the Lord has done for us in this hour, that faith may spread across this world. Acts 8 and 4 lets us know exactly when they were scattered, what they did. It says, therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. I want you to know, people, everyone listening to the sound of my voice right now, this is our opportunity to spread the word and to preach the word. This is our greatest opportunity to evangelize. I'm here to tell you, when I looked at the views from our Sunday's message, that over 4,000 people viewed that sermon. I'm here to tell you, I was blown away in my mind that people from across the country and people even in other countries would look at a southern girl like myself and hear the word of the Lord. But then I had to remember, it's not me, it's Him that's lifted up. And because He is lifted up, we get past what we look like. We get past where we've come from, and we let the word of God arise in us. This is the greatest hour of evangelism as we declare what the Lord has done for us. This is our greatest opportunity to be the missionaries to a world that has internet, but they don't have the gospel. May they hear the gospel now in Jesus' name. Church, it's time that we must arise and our enemies be scattered. As surely as the enemy thought that killing Christ on the cross would end his reign and give it into the hands of Satan, the enemy thought that this virus would destroy America and destroy the church by depleting its funds and its resources. But I'm here to declare tonight, it will not defeat us. It has woke the church up. It has moved us out, because it's expanding the gospel beyond the four walls of all of our churches. Hallelujah. With the death of Christ, it only birthed the church. With the persecution of the church, it only spread the gospel throughout Asia. With the wars of the Middle East, it only brought Christianity to a world that was bound by Islam. With the coronavirus, it awakened the church and moved us outside of our walls. We are now going into all the world, and we will make disciples of all men, and we will see them baptized in the power and in the demonstration of the Lord Jesus Christ. I love the scripture, and I've quoted it many times to this congregation here. It may seem as though it's a dark hour, and it may seem as though we are on our knees because we are weak. But Micah 7:7-8 says, therefore, I will look to the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I fall, I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light to me. My challenge to you tonight, church, is spread the gospel. Spread the word. Arise, church, and let your enemies be scattered. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, I thank you tonight for your word. I thank you, Lord, that the example that we need for this day and time that we live in, Father God, is laid out before us in Acts chapter 8. Father, there was dispersion because there was persecution. Lord, we're not being persecuted by man. We are being invaded by an invisible enemy. But Father God, I pray and I believe that it is driving us to our knees of repentance, that we, the church, will move past our pettiness. We will move past our religiosity. And God, we will get down to a place where it's no longer a form of worship, but God, it is our heart that is truly dedicated to serve you with all of our heart, and that God, we will rise up, and God, we will rise in power, we will rise in strength, and we will rise with the testimony of what Christ has done for us, because we know that the blood has been shed for us, and because you live, so shall we live also, and we will declare the works of the Lord in the land of his living. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen to this closing prayer, time of worship, as you lift up, and I even ask you just to stand where you are right now, and let's just begin to worship the Lord with this awesome song of worship in the house. Hallelujah.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. And yes, I know, my future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because my Savior lives, all my fear is gone. And yes, I know he holds my future. Life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all my fears are gone. Because he lives, everything's gonna be alright now. It's because he lives. Can somebody just lift those hands all over this room and declare? Say, because he lives. Can somebody raise up your voice and say it?
Because he lives.
Everything changes because my Savior lives.
Because he lives.
Sickness can't stay here because he lives.
Because he
Everything has to change because He lives.
God's
I can face tomorrow because my God lives. And we think